Okay, hello everybody. I think it's time to start. I'm glad to see so many people here, and welcome to our International Week. This is a combination of School of Healthcare and Social Work, and also School of Food and Agriculture. So here are present our guests from 13 different countries, and then also part of our staff members from both schools, and then students. So welcome. We have 2 hours today here, and we have 2 keynote speakers present. And the first one is David Okeyo from, I will have to look, Kenyan Nutritionist and Dietitian Institute, yes? So David will start, and then there will be Aida Moreira da Silva from Portugal, Instituto Politecnico de Coimbra. Okay, good. So David, please, you can start.
Good morning. Thank you so much, and Tina, and thank you, Helena. May I introduce myself? My name is David Okeyo. Of course, my background is a PhD in nutrition. I also have postdoc, Masters of Public Health from Maseno University and International University of Health Sciences, Kampala, in Uganda. Currently, I'm working with Kenyan government as a regulator. I'm the chief executive officer for the Kenyan Nutritionist and Dietitians Institute. I have my chairperson, who is the chair for the council, Dr. Evelyn Negrikacha, who is also from the Kenyan Nutritionist and Dietitians Institute. And I'm happy to be with you for this International Week. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you, Elena. I want, before I give my presentation, I've been in Finland 10 years ago as a visiting lecturer for some of our students from Maseno University and Kampala. And Helena says I was the first international student because that time I did not have a PhD. So that was in 2009. So I visited almost 7 cities in Finland and gave lectures in the universities of applied sciences at Vaasa, Kauniainen, and I think Kemi. Yes. So I've visited Finland quite a lot. So I'm here to be with you to give a keynote address. And my topic for the keynote address is impact of food fortification on child growth and development during complementary feeding. And this is given at the International Week for CM. Just before I give my presentation, my outline for presentation includes preliminaries. I also have some background, that is introduction to the topic, then the methodology used. And in the discussion and results, because of a purely systematic review paper, we have child growth during complementary feeding, then fortification during complementary feeding. The focus is on growth and development. Then we have a concept, impact of fortification on growth and development, case reviews, and then conclusions and recommendations. Then I have 5 key messages to make. So just as an introduction, who is the relevant audience for this? Food processors is a relevant audience for this paper. And I want to say that the keynote I'm giving is from a paper that was commissioned by the NESO Institute, the NESO company, then the nurses, then we have social workers, the nutritionist, and then teachers and policymakers and public health officers. So it's a wide audience. And the general concept for the paper fits very well within the welfare and, of course, the thematic area, welfare and in responsibility. So I hope you will enjoy the presentation. Just before, it's good to know where Kenya is. For those who have not visited Kenya, Kenya is found somewhere in Africa, East Africa, and that diagram indicates the position of Kenya. We are bordered, we are bordering Uganda, Tanzania, and Ethiopia to the north. Is I always say is one of the best maps, best shaped country. If you look at it among the African countries, that's its unique shape. Kenya is known for many things. When it comes to politics, they're always everywhere. And many other things associate Kenya or isolate Kenya in the world. So also it is important that we give a background of fortification. And the map I'm showing is a borrowed map from one of the pictures, which tries to map out the fortification legislation worldwide. And when you look at that map, you will notice that where we have the green, we are talking about countries that have adopted fortification, particularly through the food vehicles. And you'll see that the darker green is for the at least three food vehicles. And when it comes to the yellow or lemon green, number one, at least one food vehicle. And looking at the map of Europe, for example, we still do not have, in Finland, for example, we don't have so much for the food vehicles, at least one. And it's also interesting to see also countries that are having fortification of oil and fats. And just the neighbor for Finland, Sweden, is at green, indicating that they have already a legislation on mandatory fortification. And the other countries also, like we have the mandatory fortification for margarine, that is for Sweden. Of course, that indicates that fortification is moving at a very high rate worldwide. And almost every country is beginning to take mandatory fortification seriously. My focus was in relation to the infant feeding. And we know that in the supermarkets and worldwide, we have processed foods that focus more on baby, especially with the nursery companies. And in Kenya, we have had mandatory fortification through legislation, where all flours and oils are supposed to be fortified during processing before they are sold to the Kenyan public. It has good impact and it also has bad impact. So that's the background. So in the introduction now, it is important that we put across that effective feeding practices at early stages of life have a positive impact on child growth and development. And there is a growing body of literature, especially to that effect, that significantly demonstrate that negative growth of outcome with inappropriate feeding in practices. What this means is that many studies have realized that during the post breastfeeding phases, there are a lot of negative growth that takes place, particularly for the developing countries. But also for the developed countries, we have bad growth, or what we can call negative growth in terms of overweight and other conditions. So therefore, it means that introducing additional foods other than breast milk poses a high risk of deficiencies at early stages of life, and this is more so within their 1,000 days of life. So complementary feeding them becomes a high risk. Now, because of that, from the literature or studies that people have done, a causal link between infant feeding practices and growth during infancy is unquestionable, and many studies have had significant proof of the relationship. These linkages have been demonstrated, particularly in both cross-sectional studies and also longitudinal studies, those one-time studies and studies that have followed children for a long time. And the two designs have strong weight behind determination of causation. And when we talk of causation, then we are thinking about the cause and effect. And had a significant confirmation of the link between feeding practices and growth of children, leading to strong internal consistency. Out of the reviews, we discovered that there's a very strong convergence of many studies on the link between fortification of food products and the growth, linear growth of children. Now, in other countries, like particularly the developing countries, growth faltering is widespread during the critical formative years of child growth. That is, leading to both short-term and long-term consequences in relation to physical and mental development. So, when we talk of growth faltering in a developed country's perspective, then we are thinking about both the physical and the cognitive development. So that has been noticed, and therefore effective complementary feeding has demonstrated an observable positive effect on the linear growth of a child within the first 24 months. In Kenya and of course other parts of the world, we are talking of the nutrition within 1,000 days of life, which is very critical. So somehow it appears that improved complementary feeding is directly proportional to linear growth. And these empirical attestations confirm the need to for interventions that target growth enhancement during complementary feeding. Now, because of this, in the course of the review, we discovered that existing literature confirms that growth impairment can be experienced during the first immediately after birth, and may continue all through to 18 months. This period includes the complementary feeding phase, characterized by variations across households and across many other caregivers. And growth failure may be caused by an inadequate intake of macronutrients and also micronutrients. For those who are in nutrition, we understand the two categories of nutrients, which is sometimes found to be common during complementary feeding. Now, many causes of growth retardation, which occur during complementary feeding, often reflected as stunting, that is a measure of indicator for development in developed countries, have demonstrated reversibility. The provision of multiple micronutrient supplementations during 12 months corrected children growth in Mexican children, and that say indicates that with fortification, then there can be a reverse effect to the retardation or growth retardation. This outcome was also reflected in cognitive development, where micronutrient supplementation could improve cognitive indices, which is a characteristic of impairment. So with this, a common understanding from the several studies that were reviewed, that fortification of commonly used food vehicles provide an opportunity for increasing nutrient intake during infancy and has the potential to improve growth. Also, fortification, however, depends on relevant food vehicles during complementary feeding programs. And the food vehicles that are common include the staple foods, where we have the rice, of course, the condiments, where we have the soy sauce, sugar, etc., and processed foods, where we have the infant complementary foods. And then in infants and young children, fortification has demonstrated more effectiveness than supplementation. When we talk of fortification, then it is an additional nutrient component in food, and supplementation is giving an additional food on top of what is already being prescribed for the child. And this review examines, therefore, the effectiveness and the impact of fortification on growth and development of children during complementary feeding. And the focus is given to physical growth also, and differential growth and development parameters during infancy and childhood. So having said that, that is the background for this particular review. It would be important as scientists to also give an account of the methodology used to examine the several literatures and the criteria used to either exclude or include those articles that can reaffirm the relationship. And so we used what we call a mini systematic review to critically assess previous empirical studies. Those are researches that many other authors have done. And this was mainly within the PubMed and, of course, Google Scholar, then Biomed Central, among other databases. Those were the key databases from the start date to the end date of the databases at that particular time. That is until 2018. And we were using the keywords such as food fortification and growth. We also included food fortification, growth, and compensatory, or what we call feeding, complementary feeding. The objective evaluation was then applied to scan through the articles based on thematic focus, and then articles in relation to the topic of the study were isolated. And because of that, issues that were weighted for purposes of inclusion surrounded complementary feeding, fortification, and of course, in the context of young child feeding practices, as well as physical and cognitive development. And the review scanned through 186 articles closely related to the topic. Out of these, a few articles were selected after meeting the criteria set, or the threshold set. And the results identified that milk, iodine, maize meal, vegetable oils are the most commonly used food vehicles for fortification. We scanned through, at the preliminary, over 60,000 articles, but 186 had similar topic. Only 14 remained as selected articles that could justify the relationship between growth and fortification. And that is the schematic diagram indicating the methodology used in the selection. So the results. We have categorized the results in several subtopics, and in this case, we have child growth during complementary feeding. And what is critical is that introduction of complementary foods after 6 months of exclusive breastfeeding is crucial for optimal growth and development of a child within the first 1,000 days. And we know that exclusive breastfeeding by all standards is up to 6 months. So immediately after that, just as we continue to breastfeed and then bring in additional foods, or what we call the new foods, that stage is very critical, and it has a lot of risk. Complementary feeding contributes to child growth and development between 6 to 24 months, making it also a critical factor in the etiology of malnutrition. And when you talk of malnutrition here, we look at both the undernutrition and the overnutrition. So in developed countries, it is more heavier on the undernutrition, but of course in developed countries, overnutrition becomes also a critical risk. Sometimes some studies have confirmed the existence of problems characterized by suboptimal complementary feeding practices, that is in West Africa. posing a major challenge towards the achievement of minimum accepted diet. And given the importance of complementary feeding in the physical growth and cognitive development of a child, there appears to be serious gaps when normal diet provisions becomes unusual. A usual practice. Now, during complementary feeding, the high incidence of growth faltering is probably the result of questionable meal quality, also quantity and frequency of feeding. And these components of complementary feeding attempt to suggest a critical focus of the quality and adequacy of complementary foods for maximum supply of required nutrients to the body of the child. And these results may exhibit adverse consequences on growth and development. Somehow, a study of this nature seems to demonstrate a persistent positive effect on intelligence development. Because when we talk of growth of a child, then we, from the cognitive aspect, then the intelligence becomes also another critical aspect. In addition, this reaffirms the contribution of fortification on the cognitive development of children. And we know that when a child grows, it's both mental related and also the motor related. So a child that is not properly fed is likely to have a retarded growth when it comes to the brain functions. Then we have fortification during complementary feeding, and this is growth and development concept. Fortification is one of the many public health interventions towards mitigating micronutrient malnutrition for children, as well as poor growth and development of children. And so here we find that fortification refers to the deliberate addition of nutrients to food to meet the demand of increased intake requirements of targeted population. So for those who intervene, adding more nutrients to the usually cooked food becomes the focus in this case. And in many cases, fortification targets restoring nutrients that are lost during processing. So we, from the review, we discovered that a lot of processed food, for example, lose on nutrients. And so those who intervene through fortification would wish to restore that particular nutrient lost. Enhancing the nutrients lost during the processing and then enhancing nutrients levels of food vehicles that have limited content than what is required. And adding nutrients not usually present in the food that is being served, that is with regard to the vehicles that can be boosted forward. And so successful fortification during complementary feeding depend on food vehicles commonly used as complements. And we also discovered from the reviews that nearly all food vehicles used as basic minimum for complementary feeding, reviewed from previous literature, focus on micronutrient fortification. So what you'll see more in most of the packs for processed food is fortified with vitamin D, vitamin C, and of course iodine, and et cetera, et cetera. So the real focus on fortification is micronutrients. However, it is widely known in science that vitamins and minerals play a major role in the metabolic processes and are very critical in macronutrient metabolism. So the real focus is on micronutrients, and this is because metabolic processes for carbohydrates depend on vitamins and minerals. So the focus would really be very critical for micronutrients intake. And therefore, the hidden role in growth is unquestionable. So it means that in as much as we have vitamins being incorporated as additional components of food, it gives the link between micronutrients and the growth itself. In as much as we would think of the protein and the carbohydrates as being useful for growth. So then when it comes now to the impact of fortification on growth and development, which is now the real focus of the paper and giving us a systematic review, it is important to indicate that complementary feeding has a significant attributable effect on child growth. And so this opens up a gateway for fortification. Many studies have demonstrated the impact of fortification on the physical growth and also emotional development of children. A study that was conducted to investigate whether multi-micronutrients food fortification could improve the cognition of school children through systematic review process revealed a positive correlation at subsequent effect. Also, similarly, in another study made as an attempt to test the effect of milk fortified with iodine on cognitive ability of children, where a considerable favorable impact was realized on cognition of children or school children. And this relationship is not far from the truth, as iodine is needed or required for the production of thyroid hormones, which is essential for growth. Of course, we have also noticed such studies in a randomized control studies. And of course, the final outcomes indicates that there is a positive effect between fortification and, of course, linear growth and physical development. Now, some studies have focused on home fortification. This is a purely not industrialized aspect of complementary feeding and its effect on intellectual development of children in large sample surveys. And in subsequent section, the relevant selected studies are shown to demonstrate the existing relationship between fortification, growth, and development. So what I'm going to show are actually a series of critically selected studies that demonstrated that aspect of fortification. For example, a study that was done by Bohoch, which attempted to look at the effect of fortified milk on growth of and nutritional status of young children. This was a purely systematic review and meta-analysis. The design was using five databases, and the results indicated that fortified milk was found to be an effective source of complementary nutrition to supplementation. And this is one of the studies that demonstrate the relationship. Also, in among the 14, in another study that was done by Firebroth, also looked at the iodized salt and iodine supplementation for prenatal and postnatal growth. This was a rapid scoping of existing systematic reviews. The design was a systematic review, and the result out of this, although five reviews pre-specified inclusion of growth outcome, none provided synthesized evidence on the effect of iodine supplementation or fortification on prenatal and postnatal growth. What is critical for this study is that they did not come out with a concrete relationship, and it is very critical when we make now conclusions based on the relationship. Another study also was done. This looked at the effect of regular consumption of multiple micronutrient fortified milk beverages on micronutrient status of school children and on their mental and performance or physical performance. The design was a randomized double-blind placebo control study, and it indicated that on the overall improvement, there was improvement in cognitive and physical performance for such children. So this is also a study that confirms the relationship. Now, in this study, compliance with the home-based fortified strategies for delivery of iron and zinc, which is a micronutrient, its effect on hematological and, of course, growth markers among 6 to 24-old children. The design was, it used 292 children, and the results indicated that fortified complementary food and higher compliance than sprinkled and is suitable for delivery mechanisms for iron and zinc in preschool children. So this also is a sample of a study that confirms the relationship. Now, in a different study, this is by Semba, it looks at consumption of micronutrient fortified milk and noodles in how it is associated with lower risk of stunting in preschool age children. This is Indonesia. The design was looked at 2,522,500 families. And then it indicated that the consumption of fortified milk and noodles is associated with decreased odds of stunting among Indonesian children. So again, we look at a confirmation, that is a confirmation of the growth. Then in a different study which focused on impact of fortified blended food and products on nutritional status of infants and young children in developing countries, where the design also focused more on the developed aspect of the children. These are published articles. The results indicated positive effect on recovery from moderate acute malnutrition, and weight gain were observed when fortified products were given. So that's also a confirmation study out of the 14 that were critically selected. And then we looked at the effect of fortification with multiple micronutrients and of course omega-3 fatty acids on growth and cognitive performance in Indian school children. And of course, when you look at the 2x2 factorial design, double-blind randomized, the results indicated higher micronutrients treatment was beneficial for linear growth than the lower micronutrient treatment. So when you have multiple micronutrient supplementation, then the impact is higher. Then we had the growth of preschool children was improved when fed on iron fortified fermented milk beverage supplemented with what we call the lactobacillus acidophilus. The design, again, as you can see, it indicated in the results that fortified beverage contributed to improved nutrients intake and, of course, nutritional status of preschool children. That also confirms the relationship. And, of course, we can also review this study, which also gave us the good odds based on incidences. This will be available for all of us to read through in details. Then we also had a study by Faber, which focused more on the effect of fortified maize meal porridge on anemia and micronutrient status, and of course, motor development of infants. The design focused more on children between 6 to 12 months. And if you look at it, this low-cost fortified, the study indicated that low-cost fortified porridge can potentially have a significant effect on reducing anemia and improving iron status and, of course, motor development of infants in poor settings. So that was also another qualifying study for the relationship. Then we looked at fortification of maize meal, which improved with improvement on nutritional status of children. Again, we could see between 1 to 3 years some positive effect. And of course, it continues. That is also a similar study. Then we had one on vegetable oil fortified feeds in the nutrition of very low birth weight babies. And again, we look at this as another qualifying study, which was giving us a significant relationship between coconut oil group and, of course, compared to the control, we realized some positive effect from this particular study to reassure us of the relationship. And that continues also to vitamin A, fortified monosodium glutamate, and, of course, health growth and survival of children. The results here also demonstrated positive relationship with the linear growth. So, if you look at all these studies that have been included in this paper, you will notice that there is no doubt that fortification has positive growth impact for children within 1,000 days. But then what are we concluding from these studies that have been documented from different databases? Now, we are concluding that a close analysis of these studies reviewed demonstrated convergence. Many agreements came up. Convergence with a common understanding of the positive correlation between food, fortification, and the growth of children. Also, growth parameters consistently range from physical, motor, and of course, cognitive development across many studies. So when we talk of growth, we look at the physical, the motor, and also the cognitive. All these had a link. This review then demonstrates the growing literature of the impact of fortification of growth on growth and development during complementary feeding. And of course, it identified growth from the perspective of physical and cognitive dimensions. Micronutrients are major fortifiers in common food vehicles, which justifies that fortification is rather a metabolic process in cognitive growth, more in growth and also in development. So when you talk of fortification, then the focus is more on metabolism rather than the normal intake. So in the recommendation, the results based on the articles which were reviewed, which met the criteria that was used for selection, identified milk, iodine, maize, meal, porridge, and vegetable oils as recurring fortification vehicles in the context of complementary feeding. However, the review reflects outcomes that still do not demonstrate direct cause and effect relationship between fortification and growth. We cannot say that fortification has that direct effect, but we see implied effect based on the metabolic preliminaries as proxies to the outcome. And therefore, fortification should be evidence-based and implemented based on initial screening processes. So it could not be, it must not be mass fortification, but targeted evidence-based fortification. And the key players in the intervention matrix should avoid blanket or mass fortification without informed choices. So when we have promoters of fortification, putting it in the legislation to indicate that it is a must, all food vehicles are supposed to be fortified, it has also its negative impact because of the high levels and the possible risk of toxicity. And so the process should be well informed with targeted fortification. So what then are the key messages from this paper? One is that effective feeding practices at early stages of life have a positive impact on the growth and development of a child. We have to conclude that as evidenced by a growing body of literature of studies that many of us have conducted. And the next message is that fortification of commonly used food vehicles provides an opportunity for increasing nutrients intake, that is during infancy, and has potential to improve growth. Fortification, however, depends on relevant food vehicles during complementary feeding programs. And those food vehicles that are commonly used include rice, condiments, and of course processed foods. Another key message is that most studies still reflect outcomes that do not demonstrate direct cause and effect relationship between fortification and growth, but rather evidence of implied linkage. So we cannot say that this fortifier is what causes positive growth, but rather implied version through a metabolic proxy. And important caution dwells on the fact that fortification should be evidence-based and implemented based on initial screening processes or observable clinical signs for potential deficiencies. Key players in the intervention matrix should avoid blanket or mass fortification without informed choices backed up by evidence. And so campaigning for fortification across the board should be done with a lot of caution. And that's why we are saying it must be evidence-based through screening processes. So the author, and of course that is me, of this publication has to declare received a honorarium from Nestle Institute, Nestle Nutrition Institute, and of course the terms of these arrangements were critically looked at by the Kenya Nutritionists and Dietitians Institute as a policy, because as regulators we don't support. What we do is to regulate, but sometimes we give informed scientific information that would guide the processes in policy development. So this was in accordance with our policy. And of course, this is Kenya. It comes from Kenya. So this study was done on behalf of the Kenyans for informed choice, and it was particularly written when we discovered that Kenya had already adopted mass fortification of food vehicles. And there's a legislation to that effect that all milling companies and food companies must fortify their food products before they are put in the supermarket. This is mass fortification. So the work of the regulator was to inform the policymakers that they have to do it right with informed choice. And that is on that picture there is showing one of the tribes in Kenya, that is Maasai community. And this is our flag. Our flag, of course, I also say is also one of the most beautiful flags. The black there is the black people. I think if you look at me, I represent that black. White is peace for Kenya. The red is the blood that was shed before we got the independence. And green is the nature. And when you come to Kenya, we have the seven wonders of the world. That is the wildebeest. You can find them crossing to Masai Mara. This is Masai Mara. And when those who visit us, like Elena, they enjoy being covered so much with, these are the Masai community that I used to welcome our visitors. So welcome to Kenya. Kitos for those who are from this land. Of course, thank you so much for those who come from other countries. And Asante Sana is Kiswahili in Kenya. That is a version of thank you. And of course, Erokamano is where my tribe, where I come from. So I come from the Luo community. And thank you. So that is the... So, Tina, Elena, I think I'm done.
Thank you very much, yes. David. Yes. So it was very, very, very good presentation for our presentation here. And now some questions, please.
Yeah.
Yes. If you have some.
If we have some questions, I can answer in relation to...
Ei ainakaan kuulu. Kuuluuko? No? No? It's working? Yes? Kuulu. Kuulu.
Okay, if you have any questions, I will give you when
Yes. There's a question there.
Okay, I can give you this microphone.
Hello, everyone. My name Anh from the Vietnam. Yes, I get come with that. And thank you for that, the CIAM International Week. We can attend that. The really, interesting with that the presentation. That the one I have the wonder because you have some recommendation like we have to give the supplementation the food to that the child. But I just wonder why you focus on that the 6 to 24 months. Because I just thinking that can we supplement at the early stage like 3 or 4 months for that the child is okay or not? Because in my country in Vietnam some family I just wonder that because that the cut point here in the systematic review is not so really how can I say really new something for that the supplementary for that the food to that the child. Around this only 24 or the 6 months. Because in the some family in Vietnam, we also supplement the quite early, 3 or 4 months, we also have to give more the food for that the infant and on the child. So can I ask you any research and a systematic review to show something about if give early stick with that, there's something problem for that the child or not?
Okay. Can I'll take one or two and then respond. Can I respond to that first? Yes, I think the question is asking why not supplement before 6 months? Yes. Of course, this is coming from the background of informed policy for the Kenyan government, and of course I want to believe this is also for several other nations. We recommend totally exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. And going by the WHO code, 6 months is the most recommended, unless there is a high risk of a mother not able to breastfeed. So when it comes to putting in regulations, it is not cast in stone that supplementation must be after 6 months, but the most recommended on the basis of exclusive breastfeeding code of practice. So if a mother has a very high risk and they are not able to breastfeed, then supplementation would be lowered, but it cannot be put in regulations. So this is for good practice, because every mother is able to breastfeed for at least 6 months, unless other things come in, like work, and of course things that disease conditions that may make them not exclusively breastfeed. So when it comes to complementary feeding, most of the time the recommendation, it begins from 6 months. And that is why the policies and regulations and laws being formed around the supplementation should come after 6 months. Of course, we know there's also leakage for 4 months and 3 months, but it cannot be put in regulation. Otherwise, it contradicts the best practice. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Oh. Thank you. Mine is not a question, actually. It's just, okay. Mine is just to commend you, the keynote, for the good presentation, especially because of fortification of food for our infants. It is very crucial, especially when it comes to the developing countries, because this is a point at which malnutrition starts setting in. Mm-hmm. Immediately the baby is weaned from breast milk, then the kind of food that the children are fed on actually are inadequate. Mm-hmm. So fortification becomes handy for the infants. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any other question?
I just have one question. When you fortify the food, especially to infants, doesn't that lead to a higher cost? I'm just wondering, because if you have countries where there's an extreme poverty risk, which leads up to malnutrition, and the food is commercialized and fortified, are these group of women with infants, are they able to buy the food that is even that is fortified, or will they not be able to buy it? Because that's maybe a risk, you know, of the cost. Mm. If you have developing countries where there's a high risk of extreme poverty combining with malnutrition.
Good. I respond to that. I agree with you totally. And I think that was what informed this particular review, because it came at the time when there was a move by the Kenyan government, for example, to have mass fortification countrywide. So one of the questions that came up is affordability for households that are not in the status where they can afford the processed food. And that is why our conclusion was meant to clarify the matter by indicating that it has to be targeted fortification. And when it comes to targeted fortification, they normally come for as interventions by groups or NGOs or government to buy on behalf of the poor households. So it was meant to clarify that we must not insist on mass fortification, but a targeted format of fortification. Yeah, so I agree, for poor settings it might be very expensive, but they can be supported or as a matter of interventions. Yeah. Any other? Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes.